justify as the leader, but it's just a half-length advantage here. Vino Rosso comes under a ride. Mike Smith is not as justified to go just yet. Justify a length lead here as they come to the top of the stretch. Vino Rosso is second. Hofberg comes on the scene, and Gronkowski has cut the corner, and they're into the stretch. And Justify comes roaring home to a raucous Belmont Park with one furlong to run. Gronkowski and Hofberg trying to run it down. Vino Rosso is fourth, a 16th to go. Justify is still there. Justify from Gronkowski. He's just perfect.
Well, history made north of us, quite far north of us, yesterday up in New York at good old Belmont Park as Justify became the 13th Triple Crown winner here in America. Almost like a dream, considering how unprecedented his campaign and his rise in a mere 111 days from a maiden to a Triple Crown champion. Ron Nicoletti, Jason Blewett alongside. We are still probably like you trying to, knock the cobwebs out of our eyes and just trying to get back into the swing of things, because that was about as electrifying and as exciting a moment I can remember in all my life going to the track.
You know, proved his medal, went wire to wire. They made a couple of runs at him. He withstood everything and Justify just winner of the Triple Crown. So congratulations to all those connections. Looked like it was a fantastic day up there, and it certainly was a fun day down here.
It was, and down here, of course, at Gulfstream, we had a 12-pack on the Saturday card. Seemed like people were betting with both fists. The racing was terrific. We got up to the final leg of the Rainbow Six with four singles. Lo and behold, though, the jackpot, the single winner jackpot, has lived to fight another day. And just taking another step back with Justify's historic run in the Belmont Stakes, I think of Bob Baffert, who just, I mean, his resume, he's been in the Hall of Fame for quite some time. Just incredible what he can do with a top horse. And I think as well as jockey Mike Smith, and thinking of Mike Smith, when I got into the game and started going to the track, that fateful day in the summer of 93 that changed my life forever, Mike Smith, although a lot younger, was at the top of his game then. And to think a quarter century later, he's winning a Triple Crown. It's hard to fathom.
And he was a regular winter rider down here at Gulfstream during that season, so we always got to see him. And then he decided to make that move to California, and the rest, as they say, is history.
I tweeted out this morning, and it was only partly kidding. I'm going to be candid about that. Is it too early to start a petitioning or campaigning for Justify to come here to Gulfstream Park for the Pegasus World Cup in 2019. Time will, of course, tell. We'll see how many times Justify runs throughout a record-setting career. But yesterday, a lot of fun in Belmont Park, and Gulfstream, for that matter, were buzzing. But again, much like racing, and the backstretch was open this morning, and even with the Triple Crown champion yesterday, training commenced earlier today, and we've got some work to take care of here over the next half hour. Let's dive right into the action here on a Sunday afternoon, a little overcast here in Hallandale Beach. We have the opening high five and the early pick five getting underway a little after 1:15 p.m. And as we were saying, although there were four singles and the third place finisher, a single, ran gigantic in yesterday's 12th, there's that carryover.
Yeah, $427,000, so it'll be well over $500,000 today. And it was amazing. I thought that horse was going to win it. Whoever was alive with the five, boy, they had a tough beat. That horse was game as they can be. It was the number five. So we're going to start at Rainbow Six here in the last six races on the card.
50-cent late pick five begins in earnest with race number seven. And that is a sequence later on, folks, that does begin on the right foot and with some style here at Gulfstream Park, because our featured seventh race, we've got a stake on this Sunday afternoon. The Nicole's Dream jump starts that late five, obviously the second leg in the Rainbow Six, with well over, when it's all said and done, with a half a mil in the carryover.
Oh, yeah, and that stake
in the
today.
Pool, yeah.
Yeah, they're going to be fast in that stake.
Oh, there is some serious speed signed on. We're about 60 minutes out from race number one. Really good to have you with us here on this live Sunday edition of Gulfstream Today, and we'll dive dive into the early pick five that sees me using $18 worth of spreading for 50-cent increments. Speed might be the name of the game in a few races today, including the first. I'm wondering what might happen. I went three deep between Cashless Society on the rail and the returning Miss Lamborghini, who's coming off a little bit of a layoff for Kathleen O'Connell. Both of those fillies like to mix it up. I also backed myself up with a closer, the number seven, Linda Nin. In leg number two, I'm using two, Fergie Licious and Gustavo Delgado's horse, who's more of a turf horse, the six, Treat Her Like a Star. I don't care. Gustavo Delgado, Roddy, is 9 for his last 15 here at GP. What do you think of that?
That's a pretty good stat. I did not use him on the ticket. Maybe I'll have to go revisit that. He has been on fire.
Jock's race, perhaps, in race three as we get back to the turf. Just a field of seven. It's a compact cast. Dearth of early speed. I'm wondering outside of the number four, Reagan's Odyssey, who I used more as a defensive use because of her early speed. Does anybody else challenge early on? And how does a likely slow pace affect the deep closing but classy number two horse, Pat M's Image, who is the one to beat? The single comes. It's the Blue at Best Bet, the Triple B on this Sunday, June the 10th. That's the number one Hot Hippie. Now we're never turning back.
Yeah, I mean, this horse is going to be 1-2 or something like that. Supposed to win. If not there, I don't know where.
Really nice crew, yes. If Hot Hippie doesn't win today, I don't know where they take her to get the maiden diploma. She's supposed to get it done for Danny Gargan and Tyler Gaffleone. And then 1-3, they've got to clearly beat the number one, Conquest Sandman. And to an extent, the three, Chief Exchanger. I mean, two horses. We're talking, and I call them turf beasts. They are both at the top of their game right now, and it's an intriguing little matchup in race number five. But I think an apt name for Conquest Sandman, who's had very little trouble, it seems, sending his rivals right down to the mat, putting them right to sleep.
Yeah, he won the Mies approval a couple of starts back. He's a nice horse, and I really liked him.
Yeah, I'm a fan of his as well. Now, we do begin with a field on the turf listed as good. We are fast and good now. We'll keep our eyes on the weather. A little overcast, a little muggy, such is the usual this time of year in South Florida. Any changes in the track conditions, you'll be the first to know about it. So some give to the turf as we start out on the green with this 3-and-up filly mare, $10,000 claimer. It's a bit of a Gulfstream Park return for a couple of different reasons with the horse we picked on top, the number 9, Miss Lamborghini. Not only has she not run since Florida Derby week in late March, Tyler Gaffleone, after riding yesterday on a history-making day up at Belmont Park in the Big Apple, is back to South Florida.
Yeah, well, Miss Lamborghini is downshifting to the $10,000 level first race since a really couple of solid efforts at $16,000 types. Really respect the connections you just mentioned, and that was my thought process. Looking very early in the wagering right now, 7-5 on the board.
She's got some speed. She's got an outside post, so she's got to go to get position in a quick 5-furlong turf sprint. How does that affect the one, Cashless Society? It goes out for Steve Caceres, who narrowly, it was close, picked up a nice win in yesterday's nightcap.
Yeah, the nightcap just got up. Like we said, those three horses hit the wire together, and one of those was alive in the Rainbow Six. I use Gucci Girl, and same reason you use Linden Inn. I thought if the pace gets hot, that's the one that's going to close.
Yeah, we might see a very fast pace in the first today as we get on to race number two. 3-and-up Fillies and Mares on the main track. Main listed as fast. It looked to us like the main played very fair and even. Outside of last weekend when it got a little speed friendly and maybe speed crazy to an extent, it's been very fair, very unbiased. So some good news going forward here at Gulfstream Park as we move on to this field of six. We lost the number four, Better Be Fast, who would have taken some play here. Fergie Licious is the now horse. I have no qualms with her as the likely favorite and horse to beat. And you just like the way I'm assuming she's going on the dirt.
Yeah, she's coming back to 3/4 mile, posted her second consecutive sprint victory. She defeated those 12-5 state bred claimers going 7 furlongs. That was on a good track. And Yvonne Belsour, not a lot of horses, but doing an excellent job. Jose Batista in the saddle, but I want to hear about Treat Her Like a Star. I mean, just for the reasons you said, just the barn is hot.
The barn's hot, and to me, at a respectable price, she won't be favored. That trumps everything. When a trainer goes on a run like Gustavo Delgado is currently on, when you're dealing with the barn that's 9 for their last 15 here, that's 60% in the winner's circle, folks, at Gulfstream Park. I can't pass up the opportunity. Perhaps she did not care for the moisture in the track last time out. And do note, she was basically run off her feet in that race, that off-the-turf race right around Memorial Day. And the winner of that race, who won by a lot in Sound Defense. She is a major player getting back on the turf in our featured Nicole's Dream. I think this field is more to the liking, hopefully, with Treat Her Like a Star, and Six on the Dirt, where they won't get away from her with such big early speed, will be a better fit for her as well. And hopefully Gustavo, 10 for 16 coming out of that race. He's done a good job of late, though, and just think, horse like yesterday's 10th race upsetter, yeah, in Prince Tito.
Yeah, yeah, Prince Tito. Boy, three in a row for Prince Tito. That horse has been going great guns.
Yeah, the hat trick yesterday, as Ronnie was saying. Onto the turf for race number three. We move on to this field of seven in this three and up Philly Mare, $16,000 claimer out of My Own 16th on the turf. To me, the biggest plot in this race is the lack of pace and the fact that Nick Juarez on the Marcus Vitale trader change, Reagan's Odyssey, I don't think she is one of the more talented runners in the race. She might have the right running style, and if she gets out, A, is she good enough, but maybe even more importantly, how does that affect a real one-run closer? I don't think you can change the mold or the running style of, hands down, the horse to beat, the number two Pat M's Image.
I got a big scratch in here for me, and that was the number seven Indy Gita. That was my long shot of the day, and it sort of changed my race around. And of course, I had Pat M's Image in second, moved her up, dropping the notch, stretching out to a mile in the 16th, rallied to finish third, was the favorite. That was a tough bunch she faced last time out. Mike Morrison has Jose Alvarez named to ride, and I just thought that off that performance, this one was the one to beat. I'm still sad that the number seven Indy Gita got scratched.
Well, hopefully you'll have some other prices for us down the line. We still have a lot more racing to talk about on this Sunday, June 10th here at GP. I feel like Pat M's Image has done the most, and she's kept the best company in the race. Again, her running style does give me a little concern. The 8 Feed Me Carrots, not as flashy. She doesn't have the high-quality allowance optional claimers, couple of stakes races like the number two Pat M's Image has, but she's got good recent form. She's also got a barn and an outfit doing a real good job of late, Yvonne Belsour. You like Fergie-licious a race earlier, I'm going to take the barn to pull off a very mild upset. I don't think Feed Me Carrots is going to be a big price, and I like that she's not a true sort of one-run closer. She's got enough positional speed where if they go slow, she can prevent herself from getting victimized.
And yeah, I liked her a little bit more yesterday until College Holly ran. Didn't run very well yesterday, but I'm not holding that against her. Just wanted to point that out. I got her on the ticket. I think she's one of the top three in there, and I split those two with the 6 Beachwood, who's dropping, coming in from Tampa, finished fifth. I just thought that was a good performance, but I think it's Pat M's Image and Feed Me Carrots. I love that name for those two.
All right, with the C's, we get on to the number one, Hot Hippie. My best bet on the afternoon won't be a big price, but again, there are far more wagering options than just win, place, and show. My idea is to hopefully hit that early pick five ticket that you saw a few minutes back on the show for $18, as she is the anchor, and as she gets Gaffalione for Gargan, having found lately, I know she's lost here recently for this barn, who's been doing a good job at 2-1 and 4-5. However, I think looking at her last race, she proved one thing. She can't stay a mile. She just can't do it. Cutting back to 6.5 furlongs, this is supposed to be the spot.
This is the spot for Hot Hippie. And I don't know if you ever met my Aunt Betty. She was a hippie. And that's why
I'm married to one dude who is a Hot Hippie, by the way.
So Aunt Betty's turning back to the sprint distance, stalked the pace, weakened the finish 6 against similar going a mile. The reason I mentioned Aunt Betty, because Hot Hippie has got to win this race, or I got to find something underneath that wicket. But when we said that yesterday with a certain horse that we both singled, I think the horse just crossed the wire now.
Did you really have an Aunt Betty?
No.
All right. I never know with you, you know?
Betty's not an Italian name.
That's true.
Yeah, Aunt Mary, yes.
Aunt then Mary. Had an Aunt Mary as well. God rest her soul. Aunt Betty, of course, going out for Antonio Sato and apprentice Ray Lou Gutierrez, who continues to do a good job and is going to be my next subject coming up next week here at Gulfstream Park on the newest edition of Blues Clues. Let's move on to race number 5. This will not go as the technical feature today. It does amaze me, though, looking at the cast and the overall sharpness level and what have you done for me lately in this $20,000 starter allowance, that you have horses like the 1 Conquest Sandman and the 3 Chief Exchanger, who, because of the conditions, qualify for this race. And we've talked and we've seen a number of terrific recent claims like Uncle B run here at Gulfstream Park. I wholly put Conquest Sandman right up there for a multitude of reasons, including this real gritty score, 2 back on April 28th. Well, look at that race, and this is a horse by the late Scat Daddy who continues to just wow, wow, wow as a stallion. Such a shame he passed away so young, because think about this. He's got Justify and Mendelsohn in the same crop. I'm hoping Scat Daddy, though, picks up another win here, and I think a lot of people will hope for that with Conquest Sandman. The only question is, or at least potential fly in the ointment, because he's a real game horse, and you see just how determined and resolute he was back on this score, April 28th in the Mies approval. Does Fundy's Tide and or Chief Exchanger really take the race to him?
Yeah, that might happen. But Conquest Sandman has turned it back today to 7.5 furlongs. Got to remember that. He followed that victory we just showed you in the Mies approval. He runs second. They put him in the race that was going to be a mile and a half, and it was taken off the turf. It was run at 10 furlongs on the main track. It was called the Home of the Brave, and that he ran okay in there, you know, and I think that sets him up perfectly for today. But I got to put, like you did, Chief Exchanger somewhere on my ticket.
Who might be the one, because Fundy's Tide really seems, he's more of a dirt horse, and he's coming out of a huge win. I have no idea where that race most recently for Fundy's Tide came from. I remember him being bet. I thought he was overbet at 7-2, and he got a near 90 buyer and won by the length of the stretch. He's going. So what do they do with Conquest Sandman? Is it a game of chicken, a little bit of cat and mouse, and his Chief Exchanger, who is just in raging form for Elizabeth Dobles? Is he the one with Tyler that winds up just tracking those two as they're going eyeball to eyeball?
And you would think Tyler would be his M.O. in here. It's, Chief Exchanger is a really ultra-consistent son of exchange rate. He's won three of his last four races since returning to action in early February. You mentioned Elizabeth, leading jock Tyler Gaffleon. Boy, and that's why you got to use both those horses on any multiple wager ticket you put together. And I also like the two a little bit in here, Trouble and Phoenix, and I'll tell you why. Does his best running in the latter stages of the race, and this one can end up sitting a really nice trip behind all the speed we've been talking about. So if you're looking for somebody that maybe is going to sit off the pace, maybe it's Trouble and Phoenix. And I've been in Trouble in Phoenix.
I'm sure you have. That'll be a story for another time. In fact, if
Blues Cruise.
Yeah, yeah. You know what? That's a good idea. Blues Cruise. That's going to be my new cruise, you know? Anyway, folks, we've got a lot more to come. We're a little goofy on this Sunday morning here at Gulfstream. Two-year-old fillies, Rainbow Six, it's all coming your way after this quick break.
At ExpressBet, we celebrate the champions that make horse racing great. That's why we provide more ways to bet from more places than ever. We've built an entire family of brands to give players more of the rewards they deserve, give bettors the information they need to win, and provide a community for horse bettors. Because the best way to support the champions of horse racing is to champion horse racing. ExpressBet, we are racing.
Gulfstream Park rocking yesterday on Belmont Stakes Day 150, and we appreciate everybody supporting our brand and the product here year-round with both fists and with such gusto. Ronnie and Jason back with you live on this Sunday edition. The day after Justify's historic Triple Crown bid as the 13th Triple Crown champion up in New York. But again, the show goes on. You win the Triple Crown. The next question is, well, where are you going to run next? And for us, we've got 11 races today and a ton of dough in the rainbow.
Yeah, Rainbow Six, as we mentioned, going to be over $500,000 very easily. I got a $43.20 ticket. And I always like when the Rainbow Six starts with the two-year-olds, because you get to watch the board a little bit. I added three there, but I might watch the board and add one more. And then our seventh race today is our stakes race, and that's the Gulfstream. And as we said, there's going to be a lot of speed in there with Ms. Mayhem and Sound Defense. I use both of those. I hope they don't knock each other out and some closer comes and gets it. And you see the rest of the progression for $43.20. Couldn't find that one single today.
Field of Six, the old six pack. These are two-year-old Philly Open maidens, in fact, ready to gun for a top prize of $65,000. That's a nice purse, but far behind that $427,000 going into Sunday's Rainbow Six carryover. We sprint. We're on the main 4.5 furlongs. And again, one scratch of Antonio Sano's Philly. Antonio, though, still in the mix with Edgar Zayas bias on a Bodemeister Furster, the number two, Miss Marcella. This is really a case where this field of six, I, at least in my mind, have split up into two nice groups, three second-time starters and three first-time starters. Now, in regards to the firsters, I have a feeling, I haven't heard anything, but judging from what I've seen with the number six, Miss Aramette, and the money this daughter of Uncaptured brought, Nabreeze, will bring you back from OBS during their two-year-old, their select two-year-old in training sale a couple months back, I have a feeling not only will this filly be fast, I have a feeling she's going to be bet today. A little left-handed urging in this work, but boy, she looks like she's got a powerful stride at a very strong hind end, and you see that furlong Breeze in that OBS sale working an eighth of a mile in 10 flat. Considering, and we'll bring up the Blewett's Bullets next, that she sold for just $42,000 as a yearling and was later pinhooked for $135,000 in that sale, I think that's a great sign. And we have really seen, it's early, don't get me wrong, I know it's only June 10th, but this young Florida-based stallion up at Ocala Stud and Uncaptured, he's gotten off to a great little start, and I think he may have a runner here for Eddie Pleaser Jr.
Lots of good angles there, and it could be as simple as that. That's why I mentioned, watch the board when these horses run. I did go with one of the horses that did start, and that's the seven, First Time Proud. I think is sitting on a winning performance after rallying to finish second best in its career debut at this level and distance. It's Dave Braddy, and he's got it working nicely, a solid half-mile work, maintenance work at Gulfstream Park West. So it looks like she's coming into the race in good form, or he's coming into the race in good form.
Now, you've got two, in fact, coming out of that same race from May 10th. You like the seven, First Time Proud. We've also got the Stanley Gold trained filly by Brethren out of an old mare who I remember up in the Big Apple for Jimmy Jerkins named Dat You Ms. Blue. That is Leilani. For a barn that's really gotten good, Stanley six for his last 23 over the past 30 days, and do you see some improvement here, maybe second time out?
Absolutely, and he's got the Jeffrey Sanchez, and they have teamed up for a couple of really nice two-year-old victories. Want to show you a little stat, maybe a little disconcerting. This one, the second career start, two-year-olds with first lace, excuse me, in the dirt. He's 3 for 22, only 14% with 45% in the money, but that is can change because this barn is on fire.
Yeah, barn's going great. Jeffrey's going great. Clearly, both physically and as far as his psyche, in a very good place. And you would expect a bigger effort, a more polished effort, and perhaps a little more early speed. She broke fine. She broke great, actually, first time out. Just couldn't keep up at 4.5 furlongs. I think you get a better effort out of her today. But again, I also think Miss Aramette is going to come out running. Let's move on to race number 7. Here is the centerpiece, the spotlight race, if you will, on this Sunday, June 10th. No Triple Crown post doldrums this afternoon as we bring on a pretty classy crew, three and up fillies and mares in this 5 furlong turf sprint. Speed, and more speed. And how does the pace affect the number 5, Ms. Mayhem, as we start the late pick 5? Now, I went, as far as my spreading, $27 with this ticket. Again, it's a good test for the likes of Island Reward, the 1, as well as the speed horses, Sound Defense, and Ms. Mayhem. It's just a good test for all three and a good race to start things out. 3 deep and a very big scratch. The good and the bad with Hidden to Win out of race number 8 is you lose a potential single, but you have a much better betting race with no Hidden to Win, right?
Yeah, Connie? Just all wide open in there, and I think Beauty of the Day, they must have been dancing in the street, the connections, when they saw that horse scratched.
A good size field in the 9th, but I really prefer Edgar Zayas, my man EZ, on the 1, Bullet the Blue Sky, and Tyler Gaffleone riding the 2, Mo's Ginny. They have good posts.
I get the Bullet thing there.
Yeah, you got the Bullet. There we go.
I got those. I think you got the logical horses on
Blew it, Bullet the Blue Sky. All right, race number 10. I'm not sure if I completely, and we'll talk about it more in depth in a couple of minutes. I feel as though the 10th race centers around Noble Venezuela. Big drop horse that, if he's right, will bury that field, or at least will be tough to beat. But I see 6-1 on the line.
Yeah, I think it'll be less than that in a return of Sebastian Saez today.
I know,
riding,
yeah.
The number 1 Noble Venezuela.
Yeah, so Sebastian's got a couple of live horses, that is, on today's card. And maybe a shaky single, I get that. The number 7, Tiz from Boston. Love these Tizways on the turf, and this horse has been turf meant for quite some time. Mother Nature has not complied. Today is a different story. My feeling is for about 30 bucks, a little under 30 bucks, if I can get up to that horse in the nightcap, who won't be that short of a price to begin with, maybe I can turn him into a 50 or 60 to one shot for very little money. So that is my MO this afternoon. And again, we begin this sequence in style with race number 7. Again, the pace has to be mentioned here, Ronnie, because you have got some serious run-and-gun, take-no-prisoners-types horses in the race. And how will that affect this young 3-year-old filly for Eddie Plesa Jr., the number 5, Ms. Mayhem, who is stepping up in class but is on. Boy, is she on a nice little win streak right now, having won her last 3. Here's her victory, April 27th in the Cedar Key, where she was able to win tracking outside. It's not like she just, by blunt force trauma, got the lead and never looked back. She was able to at least range up alongside a rival and eventually put that one away. Does that shade of versatility potentially serve her well?
Absolutely. That's the reason I went with her on top, because she's a swift daughter of Yes by Yemeni, was the real dove, 3 consecutive victories, and you see it right there in the Cedar Key. But she stalked that day and pounced. So I think if she could sit behind the speed, because they're telling you right now, sound defense is going.
She is going, and I'm hoping she just flat out outbreaks Ms. Mayhem and the 6 Ladies Island, and she never looks back. I feel as though, and Mark Cassie and his team had done a nice job and had done a nice job with this daughter of First Defense last summer. I feel as though with trainer Ralph Zadey, who seems to have more high-quality 5-furlong turf sprinters than any other trainer or barn in South Florida, I feel as though he's got her breathing fire and just in the best form of her life.
But we've got to mention the number 1 Island Reward just quickly. A previous winner at the distance, hoping to bounce back at this 5-furlong distance. Come up empty. That was in that 1-mile powder break. What I like about this was, I think they're getting ready for this horse to run okay at this distance with those back-to-back bullet workouts in preparation for the shorter distance. This one might sit in the car. These two might go, and Island Reward might sit right behind them and score.
She's classy. In fact, I think she classes up more than fairly to the two fillies we just talked about. She's going to get a wicked pace, and if you're able to get away, I'm be very curious to see if she's got the front bandages on, because she wore them out of the blue last time out, and that race was a real stinker. Right. She's a little fresher. She's got about 45 days between starts. We'll keep tabs on Island Reward if those fronts are back on, or if they're off, I should say. And she has got a big chance. She's one of 3 major players in a good race. On to the 8th. Here we go. 3 and up. Fillies and mares on the main track as we go the mile. You can take out the 7, hitting the win. It was going to be an overwhelming favorite. That leaves us with a field of 6. And to an extent, that really, Ronnie, I think first and foremost, might move up the number 3, Luna Lunita, who could get loose in here. I'm glad you and I both have her in the mix.
Yeah, I mean, that can be the case in there. I did use Beauty of a Day. As I mentioned, you've been chasing hitting the win around in like 3 different starts. Maybe with her out, could win Flying Girl. I have on the ticket with the 3. But of course, that I went back after the scratch because I had to add another horse. Turned out to be the number 1, and that's Queen's Court, is dropping to this level on the dirt. Shipped in from Tampa, stalked the pace, and faded behind 8. Behind who? Feed Me Carrots. Use that race as a guide. Maybe you throw this one on the ticket.
Sounds good. Race number 9, 3 and up, fillies and mares. We're back on the turf at 1/16 here on this Sunday, June the 10th. Inside post in a good-sized field. And look at that, Ronnie and I, basically the cold super. We've got Edgar, we've got Tyler, we've got arguably the 2 best horses going into this race to begin with from the best post with the 1, Bullet, the Blue Sky, and the number 2, Mo's Ginny, who I get a little Uncle Mo action
there
here.
There you go. Mo's Ginny dropping to the 10 level, returning to the turf after back-to-back sprints in the main track, including a victory a couple of starts back. Uncle Mo, daughter of, 6-for-15 in the money on the turf. You got to like that. You got to like Tyler. You got to like Bullet, the Blue Sky. And I want to show you a little stat on Freckle D. Freck, Marcus Vitale. A little bit of a negative stat, maybe just help you decide what you want to do. Dirt to turf, sprint to route, in claimers, he's only 1-for-14, 7%, 29% in the money, and not even a 50-cent return of investment. Just something to throw out.
No, I like
there.
That stat.
You know, just to let people know maybe this is in his game.
Yeah, this is an outfit that has a pretty big barn in terms of numbers. Mostly runs in claiming races. It's more of a claiming blue-collar barn, which is fine, and Marcus does a great job. However, clearly that is a short-priced angle that's littered with past losers at short odds is what I'm trying to say. Not a good move there. Good nugget. Let's move on to race number 10. We're on the main final dirt race today at GP. These are three and up $12,500 claimers. And as we work our way through this field of seven, when I first looked at this race, now maybe I'm wrong, you're wrong, or the morning line is a little off here. Man, I thought Noble Venezuela would be favored coming in off a four-month layoff, knowing that, A, this horse fires fresh, and, B, if he's close to 100%, he will be very, very tough to beat. I thought the race centered around him, the drop, the layoff, and how you would proceed, whether you liked him or not, and clearly you like him to win.
Yeah, he's breaking from the rail and making his first start. He finished third. That was that hard-knocking group he faced of 12-5 state-bred optional claimers before that four-month layoff. So he is coming off a layoff. Sebastian Saez will be in the saddle this afternoon. Color Me Pom Pom and the horse you have on top. Tiger Blood I have on my ticket also.
Who's just very logical. He's run okay. I thought he'd get a pretty good trip, especially if you're dealing with the Noble Venezuela, who's no longer up to those fast races that he had, mainly that one in the slop here last July. And it's funny, at the time, I thought Yvonne Belsor and Bruno Schickendonz, because they jumped in and claimed this horse off a big drop and a long layoff. I said, oh, maybe they claimed the stakes horse. Hasn't really worked out that way, but again, Tiger Blood is logical, as is the seven, Color Me Pom Pom, who has not won a race in about 24 and a half months, but is taking a big drop.
Big drop today, and I think this horse always there, seems to be there. Maybe the big drop helps. Noble Venezuela, I thought you would have it on top of your ticket.
We're running out of time. Why don't we show you, though, when this horse is right, he can bring the thunder, he can bring the power, and he can bring that early speed. Now, in terms, and this is, by the way, a race a long time ago. This was back just on February 9th, and he ran a great race that afternoon. He did not have an easy time of it at all back on February 9th, again, about 4 months ago. When you consider he was in with Salute with Honor and Social Roy, and then boom, today he's off that four-month layoff. He's in for 12-5. He only gave way grudgingly in deep stretch. Again, I feel as though, so does Ronnie, 10th race centers around Noble Venezuela. Let's do the last quickly here, my friend, as we wrap up the week and the card at 7.5 furlongs on the turf. These are made in 12-5 claimers. Oh, dude, what are you doing picking my horse, man?
I just picked this one who I thought might win, dropping to 12-5 level. We're talking about Tiz from Boston. You know, he has that breeding needed to handle the surface switch. Dave Braddy, MCL Jaramillo, son of Tizway. 11 horse, 271 in second.
Who probably has. It's just that kind of race. Lower level maiden claimer, late in the day. There's not much turf for him. There's not much consistent for him. He narrowly is probably the horse to beat, the number 11, 271. I don't know much. I do know Tizway is an awesome turf sire, and his horses can step up first time on the grass and strike at a price. Don't know how big a price Tiz from Boston will be, but let's get the money here. A little Tizway and Woodman.
Woodman? Who's
Woodman.
That?
That's the damn sire,
oh,
dude.
Oh, so you know everything. I don't know all that
It's
stuff.
Right there in black and white. Also in black and white, scratches and changes on the card today. So, again, you might be a little groggy. You might have a bit of a post-Belmont Stakes Day hangover. We do as well, but the show goes on here, folks, at Gulfstream Park. Pete Aiello sitting on a buyer of about 125 as he takes the stage next for those Sunday scratches and changes.
Passion for horses and a commitment to breed champions is the foundation of Hardacre Farm. Founded by Amy Tarrant, owner, breeder, and trainer, Hardacre Farm, based in Ocala, continues its tradition of success. From the Breeders' Cup to Gulfstream Park, Hardacre Farm. From the breeding shed to the racetrack, in pursuit of producing the best.